this lecture, I want to discuss acute cholangitis. I want to mention a few highlights. We'll talk about the pathogenesis, how acute cholangitis develops, the organisms involved and the microbiology, what the clinical picture is, what you should look out for when you see patients, the special investigations that you can do either laboratory-wise or on the imaging side. We want to talk about the management of this very dangerous condition, and we'll look at some specific types of cholangitis, the parasitic infections, AIDS cholangiopathy, and then lastly, recurrent pyogenic cholangitis. Let's start. The highlights. What is cholangitis? It's a potentially life-threatening obstruction and infection of the biliary tree. Lots of alternate terms. Some people talk about ascending cholangitis. Some talk about suppurative cholangitis. It's all about the infection and growth of organisms in an obstructed biliary tree. What do we look out for? It's Charcot's triad. What is that? It is these three symptoms and signs: a right upper quadrant pain, a patient with fever who actually has chills, that refers to the bacteremia that we have here, and of course, jaundice. Those three combined is called Charcot's triad. Now, 80% of cases of ascending cholangitis is from cholelithiasis. That means gallstones in the biliary tree. The rest, the patients that we see have either benign or malignant biliary strictures, can develop as a complication of pancreatitis and also of biliary parasites, and we'll look at that. What is the priority in the management of these patients? It's fluid and electrolyte resuscitation, broad spectrum antibiotic cover, correction of your coagulopathy, because most of these patients will go for some form of procedure, and the mainstay of therapy is biliary drainage. You've got to drain that pressurized, infected biliary tree. Good, let's start with acute ascending cholangitis. I'm going to mention the pathogenesis, the causes, the microbiology, the clinical features, the investigations, and the management. So, I've said it before, it's a partial or complete obstruction of the biliary tree, which then overwhelms the normal defense mechanisms. Human beings don't develop cholangitis. You have an intact sphincter of Oddi that keeps organisms out of the biliary tree. You have enterograde flow of bile that washes the system out. Bile salts help in the prevention of infection. Immunoglobulin A produced by the cell walls. In the liver you have the Kupffer cells, which take part in normal defense of the biliary tree. So these get overwhelmed because of various circumstances. You get multiplication of organisms, the pressure inside the biliary tree increases, very good blood supply, those organisms get into the bloodstream, you have a bacteremia, and the patient goes into septic shock. Various thoughts as where these organisms actually come from. They might be from the duodenum itself, from the portal venous system, some would suggest, periductal lymphatics, secretions from the liver itself, an infected gallbladder. There's a variety of ways for organisms to get into this obstructed biliary tree. Irrespective of where they come from, with the raised intraluminal pressure, it does lead to systemic bacterial seeding, and as I mentioned, leads to bacteremia, septicemia, septic shock. Again, just with the causes, as I said, 80% plus are gallstones, secondary stones, that mean gallstones that come from the gallbladder, primary stones, stones that develop inside the biliary tree themselves. You can also mention some complicated forms of stone complications such as Maritzi syndrome, we can also put there. Then we see bile duct strictures lower down, you get benign and malignant ones, benign. Post-operative, a patient might have had an injury during a cholecystectomy. Acute and chronic pancreatitis can lead to damage and stricture formation of the distal common bile duct. primary sclerosing cholangitis, where there's fibrosis in the biliary tree, autoimmune cholangitis, cholelidocal cysts, biliary atresias, and on the malignant side, cholangiocarcinoma, pancreatic cancers in the head of the pancreas, and pulmonary and duodenal cancers, gallbladder cancers, and even a large volume of metastatic lymph nodes in the porta hepatis. All those malignancies can cause and will cause obstruction of the biliary tree. Instrumentation further down the line. Any patient who's had cannulization of their biliary tree via ERCP, placement with a stent, obstruction of that stent, any exogenous material that goes into or procedures done on that biliary tree can cause cholangitis. Infections, parasitic, well described in certain parts of the world. On the other side, we do get the AIDS cholangiopathy, I'll talk about that, the oriental or recurrent pyogenic cholangitises, and various fungal infections, so a myriad of causes. Most commonly though, you are going to see stones and malignancies. 80% of people will have organisms on a blood culture. It's very important to do a blood culture before starting broad-spectrum antibiotics as the patient is admitted and diagnosed. Most of these organisms are enteric in nature, so we're talking gram-negatives. Once a patient has had instrumentation, for instance an ERCP, or they've had surgery though, most of these infections become polymicrobial, and you can see all sorts, gram-negatives, even gram-positives, and anaerobes, importantly the anaerobes. So what are we talking about? E. coli, Klebsiella, Enterobacter species, also some enterococci, and as I said, patients with instrumentation, got to look at the anaerobes, bacteroides, and clostridia. In Asia, we really have to think about parasites and secondary bacterial infection, not so common in the rest of the world. In immunocompromised patients, specifically Africa, South America, areas such as this, where we see hepatitis C and HIV with cryptosporidium or cytomegalovirus or even candida infections. So a wide variety of organisms to consider when deciding on antimicrobial therapy. So what does the patient present with? I've mentioned Charcot's triad. Now only 20 to 50% of people will actually have that very nicely defined picture. There's also Reynolds pentad, pentad referring to 5, and that's just the addition to Charcot's triad of hypertension and an altered mental state. Now, there's nothing special about this Reynolds pentad. What is described here is a patient who's in septic shock. The process has gone on too far, might have taken time for the patient to present, or there was an initial misdiagnosis in hospital, time has passed, patient will eventually develop septic shock, and that is what Reynolds pentad refers to. Jaundice also, not everyone with cholangitis has jaundice, seen in 60 to 70% of cases, certainly the majority, but don't be fooled that if there's no jaundice, this cannot be cholangitis. It is still possible to be cholangitic without jaundice. Vast majority of patients will be though. What am I trying to say is have a high index of suspicion, especially in the elderly. They're not going to have all the symptoms and signs. Those with known anatomic abnormalities, they've had a lab coli before, they're known to have an injury, they've had instrumentation before. If they present with pain and fever, with or without jaundice, always a high index of suspicion that this might be cholangitis, and it might be worth your while to institute antibacterial therapy and get your investigations done and your management. What are you going to see on the blood test that you do? Well, of course, you're going to send away full blood count. With that, you're going to see either normal white cell count with a bit of a left shift, that's earlier, later on full-on leukocytosis, and most commonly a neutrophilia. If you do an ERCP, it will be raised. It might be raised from a variety of causes, but certainly a raised CRP that keeps on rising is very suspicious. On your liver function test, you are going to see a cholestatic picture. What is that? You're going to see a conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. As I mentioned, not everyone's jaundiced, not everyone is going to have a raised bilirubin levels, but certainly it would be in the vast majority of cases. Together with that, your ductal enzymes will be up. Those are ALKphos, alkaline phosphatase, and gamma GT. Not uncommon though to see the cellular enzymes raised as well, ALT and AST. You have to do blood cultures before starting antibiotics, but don't let the taking of the blood cultures delay the start of the broad spectrum antibiotics. But it helps you to de-escalate, it helps you to know what organism you're dealing with a couple of days down the line. Imaging is important. Patient might have the clinical picture. We've instituted our management, and I'll talk about that. But we have to confirm the diagnosis in some other form. Now, the choice of imaging really depends on the availability and the patient's condition. Now, a transabdominal ultrasound would be the first investigation most facilities would have available. It's easy, it's non-invasive, and it's very good to show biliary dilatation. Of course, further down the tree, it might get a bit difficult, hidden behind the gas in the duodenum. Endoscopic ultrasound, as opposed to transabdominal, is a newer modality, not available commonly in many centers, and expertise for it does not exist everywhere, but it has become part of the working algorithm of many advanced units dealing with cholangitis. FNA aspirate can be taken, and a variety of procedures can actually be performed with endoscopic ultrasound. It really gives you excellent sensitivity for common bile duct stones. All variety of ductal malignancies can be diagnosed. You can get tissue from an endoscopic ultrasound, as I said. And it really can also be less invasive than an ERCP. We move on to a CT scan. Now, a CT scan is going to be excellent to show you other causes other than stones. Not all stones are seen on a CT scan, but certainly malignancies and pancreatitis as cause of cholangitis can be seen. Remember, it is like the transabdominal ultrasound, purely diagnostic. There is a radiation risk, and there is the risk of giving contrast to these patients who might have a borderline renal function due to their septic state. So just be careful there. MRCP, beautiful to do, nice delineation of the anatomy, very sensitive for detecting the bile duct stones and other causes of the obstruction. Again, purely diagnostic, expensive, limited availability, long waiting lists in many places, and of course patients with the large metal implants can't have an MRCP. Then we get to the ERCP, that is the gold standard, and it's preferred for the severely ill patients. You've got to decompress the bile ducts as soon as possible, and most common way to do it is via an ERCP. Now, PTC, one should also put in here as part of the imaging. That is where we're going to get access to the bile ducts, not as ERCP, which is endoscopically via the stomach and duodenum, but transcutaneously, where access is gained through the liver itself. Management. Well, we know now about the laboratory investigations, we know about the special investigations, but as far as the diagnosis, confirming the diagnosis is concerned, we do go for this updated Tokyo guidelines. You see the A, B, and C, that's systemic inflammation, cholestasis, and imaging. Under systemic inflammation, called A, temperature more than 38 degrees Celsius or chills, white cell count less than 4, more than 10, under cholestasis, a raised total bilirubin or alkaline phosphatase, gamma GT, AST, ALT more than 1.5 times normal values. And under C, imaging biliary dilatation from whatever imaging technique you use, or on the actual imaging techniques, the cause seen, either strictures, stones, or stents. Now, if you have at least one in all three of A, B, C, that's a definite diagnosis of acute cholangitis. If you have one in A, so they either have a temperature and chills or a raised or very low white cell count, and then one from B or C, just one. So you certainly don't always need that raised bilirubin. It is very suspicious of cholangitis. And that is the updated Tokyo guidelines for diagnosis. So what do you have to do? You really have to distinguish initially between mild, which might be self-limiting, and then the severe disease that is life-threatening. If you do nothing about it, the mortality rate is extremely high. So what I mean by this mild self-limiting, if we think about stones, it is quite possible that a stone can pass spontaneously. Don't rely on that happening though. A case that you see that's now mild will not be mild again tomorrow. You've got to keep your eye on that patient. Sydney, they don't have to be rushed off for an ERCP, but you might very well find that the next morning the temperature's down, the bilirubins are improving, the pain is gone, and it might very well be that that stone has passed. More commonly though, you have to interfere. You have to do something about it. That stone does not pass spontaneously and the situation will deteriorate. So what do? We initiate fluid resuscitation and electrolyte correction. Some of these patients do have electrolyte abnormalities and it forms part of your fluid resuscitation. So you commence antibiotic cover, broad spectrum, talk about that, and you do it after taking cultures. Do not delay giving the antibiotics though, just to get the cultures, but in a well set up system that should be easy to do. You've got to also diagnose and correct the coagulopathy. Most of these patients are going to go for ERCP and you want to know that they don't have coagulopathy, which they might very well have. You are obstructing the biliary system, and that is in the liver, at least is where you make your clotting factors. So antibiotics, your choice is really, it's irrespective of bile penetration. You have such high pressures that it makes penetration poor, even of well-excreted or hepatically excreted antibiotics. It really is not that important, or bile penetration is really not that important. So if a patient comes, community-acquired, acinetic cholangitis, with a stone, or malignancy, broad-spectrum penicillins, most notably, we do use amoxicillin with clavulanic acid, or even ciprofloxacin, as far as the quinolones goes, might be good first choices. Remember I said you have to think of anaerobes and the elderly, those with altered anatomy or those who've had prior instrumentation, and for those it is advisable just to add metronidazole. If this is hospital acquired and the patient is severely ill in septic shock, you might want to go one step up, start very broad spectrum with carbapenems or fourth generation cephalosporin. And we usually stop when improving after the drainage. There's no such thing as a course of antibiotics. And really, if they have mild self-limiting and well-responding cases, you might only use antibiotics for 3 days. And if they're very severe and they've had their drainage, you might want to stop after about 5 to 7 days. You want to see that the patient has responded well, that there's no more signs of sepsis, and you can discontinue the antibiotics. Of course, once your MCNS results are out, you can de-escalate, specifically in the severely ill that have gone to the intensive care unit, that you have started on the very broad spectrum carbapenems or fourth generation cephalosporins. You want to de-escalate. And that is why it's so important to get your blood cultures. I've said it many times now, biliary drainage is the most important aspect of the management. And it can occur naturally, don't depend on that. By intervention, most commonly. So what are the interventions possible? Endoscopic, ERCP, percutaneous transhepatic, a PTC. Some of the centers have this EUS and they have built it into their management algorithms and the various techniques that I will just quickly mention. If nothing else is available, none of this, patient's extremely ill, do not forget good old-fashioned open surgery, common bile duct exploration, decompress that, leave in a T-tube, and we can always think about definitive therapy later if the stone cannot be extracted under that first setting. Stone's easy to extract it during that time. If patient's too unstable, can't get to the stone, too difficult, just put in a T-tube and get out. Of course, that has got to be proximal to the obstruction. No use putting a T-tube distal to that. Good. So endoscopic biliary drainage. Vast majority of the patients are going to have an ERCP and drainage. And in most places of the world, at least there's access to, perhaps not at the facility, but you are able to transfer the patient in a stable condition to a center that allows for this facility. So get a patient to a center with ERCP expertise. The severely ill within the first 24 hours, really 24 might be too long. That's really the outside limit. Get them to ERP's facility. They need cannulization of the biliary tree and drainage of the duct, and if possible, removal of the obstruction, if a stone is the cause, of course. If they're moderately ill, really within, you know, there's always these admissions on a Saturday or Sunday, within 48 hours at least, you want that drainage to be done. After it's cannulized, the biliary system is cannulized, it is decompressed first, and that aspirate is then sent for MCNS. There are a variety of things to do, and it is at the choice of the endoscopist. They might do stone extraction right there and then, with or without a sphincterotomy. Now, sphincterotomy allows for larger stones to be extracted, easier stone extraction. It does lower the recurrence of cholangitis, but there is this risk of bleeding, perforation, and you increase the risk of pancreatitis. So it's a decision to be made. It might not be possible to extract the stone or the cause of the obstruction. You might have to leave a drain or a temporizing stent. It might even be the prudent thing to do if the patient is so severely ill that there really isn't time for anything more complicated and you just want drainage. That is at the discretion of the endoscopist. So what is the role of a PTC then? Percutaneous transhepatic. So access is going to be gotten to the biliary tree through the skin, through the liver, advance deeper and deeper until one of the larger biliary ducts are cannulated, selding a technique over that guide wire, or through the needle a guide wire, and over the guide wire a drain. So it's more accessible. Many centers won't have ERCP, but they will at least have radiology that can help with a PTC. It can be done under local anesthesia. It can be done in a very unstable patient that cannot go for general anesthetic, cannot be transported to the endoscopy unit. Patient might just be too unstable. There's no, I think, RCTs really to show which one is better. Of course, many units are set up for an ERCP. It's much more definitive as far as the stone extraction is concerned, or getting biopsies at least, if it's malignant. Many more things to be done by ERCP, and that is preferred. There's higher morbidity mortality to the PTC. We see a lot of pain, bile peritonitis, hemorrhage, hemobilia, definitely increased length of stay. So we really do reserve it for the unstable patients and the patients that have a high lesion, a hilar lesion, for instance, with cholangiocarcinoma, with cholangitis, that still need decompression because of that worsening cholangitis. So really just for those patients and the very, very unstable with cholangitis, we consider PTC. So the ultrasound-guided biliary drainage, very specific to advanced centers and their algorithms. It's usually used when there's ERCP failure. There's the two techniques of getting biliary drainage, the so-called rendezvous technique and the colodogo duodenostomy technique done over dilatation over a guide wire. So know about these, know that it's available, but as I mentioned, really in advanced units. Then, the vast majority of cases are from secondary gallstones, that means gallstones from the gallbladder, and it's prudent to do a cholecystectomy after the patient has recovered fully to prevent further stones going down the cystic duct into the common bile duct. I want to mention parasitic infections seen in tropical countries. It's diagnosed by microscopy of the stool bile or duodenal aspirate, where you see the parasites. Serology is really of secondary value. You might get positive serology because the patient does have the parasites, but his jaundice is not because of parasitic infection of the biliary tree. So it doesn't always help, and you're going to get a lot of negative serology, false negatives and false positives. It is managed medically, medication, and then reinvestigation of the patient. And only in cases where your medical management against the parasites, with or without antibiotics, fail, that you would consider an ERCP. More importantly, certainly around these parts, is the AIDS cholangiopathy. It is a form of sclerosing cholangitis. In other words, there's fibrosis in the biliary tree as well. And it results from infection by specific opportunistic organisms, mostly cryptosporidium and cytomegalovirus. Patients present with right upper quadrant pain, fever and chills, and nausea. So they look like cholangitis, except that most of them are not jaundiced. You do the liver functions, though, and you see a cholestatic picture with normal or near-normal bilirubins. CD4 count is usually quite low, less than 100. We will do an ultrasound under these sort of circumstances. It'll see the duct dilatation. You can do a CT scan and give you better delineation of the intrahepatic ducts, at least. ERCP will show signs, at least, of AIDS cholangiopathy. So pictures that are seen are the sclerosing cholangitis with papillary stenosis, the sclerosing cholangitis alone, that's the fibrosis in the biliary tree, the papillary stenosis alone, or those with the long extrahepatic strictures with or without intrahepatic strictures. So different pictures that are seen in ERCP. Antimicrobials are usually ineffective in these patients. If they have papillary stenosis, sphincterotomy will be of help. If the strictures are higher up, you can consider balloon dilatation or placing of stents. If it's higher up, it might be problematic. Might have to do it via PTC. Now, the institution of heart has really returns the patient's immune function, and in countries where there's a good program with treating these patients, we really see seeing less and less of the H cholangiopathy. Lastly, recurrent pyogenic cholangitis. It's a primary, also known as primary hepatic lithiasis, recurrent pyogenic cholangitis, oriental cholangiohepatitis. There's intrahepatic stones and recurrent attacks of cholangitis. There is an association with parasitic infections. And what we usually see is pigment and stones with calcium bilirubinate. And the hallmark of this is repeated attacks. And the treatment will basically be, as we've discussed before, other than the fact that the fibrosis might develop. And, as you see at the bottom, they might eventually develop secondary biliary cirrhosis in 10%, and up to 10% might even develop cholangiocarcinoma. So either ERCP or PTC is still going to drain the system. As I said now, these strictures do cause the problems, and it might even be so bad that we need segmental resections of the liver. So that is it for acute cholangitis. Most importantly, fluid resuscitate the patient, start broad-spectrum antibiotics after getting blood cultures, and get your imaging. You are going to see the obstructive pattern on your liver functions. Remember the Tokyo guidelines for the diagnosis. An ultrasound, which most of us will start with, you'll see the dilatation. You might have a CT scan as well, which will give you a bit of better definition and show the other causes, as I said. And then the patient needs drainage. After the drainage, the patient needs, eventually, when they are better, a cholecystectomy. Thanks.